So the next speaker will be Luca from Italy, and he will be talking about serverless IoT. And yeah, it will be great because I love working with Raspberries and things like that. And he will show a great application of using CDK with local devices. And I'm happy to hand over.
Thank you, Thorsten. Thank you very much. And for the next half hour, I'm here to talk to you about what we have done with serverless and our CDK local development for devices. But first of all, who am I? I'm Luca Bianchi. I am Chief Technical Officer at New Experience and at Whiskey, which are two Italian-based companies. And moreover, I am co-organizer at Serverless Meetup and Serverless Days. This means that I love serverless. I have been awarded as AWS Serverless Hero recently, and I'm an AWS Community Builder. Please get in touch with me. These are my references, and you can also see my Twitter handle on my name in the video. So please get in touch with me, and we could discuss about that. Today, I'm going to talk to you about HVAC system, which means that we are going to talk about a customer that we work with, which is an Italian-based company that has expertise in heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system worldwide. It's a NAFCA certified company. NAFCA is the US organization that certifies system air quality throughout the United States. And my company, which is New Experience, is a company that helps other brands to innovate their products and build smart products. And especially in this case, we built Alizea Remote Air, which is a smart product that leverages Alizea expertise in duct and air conditioning cleanliness to build a completely new smart IoT product. Building a completely new smart IoT product means that we needed to project and to deploy its architecture. And this is the reason why I'm talking to you about this right now today, because this means that we had to build this kind of infrastructure, and we managed to achieve that using CDK. But we have a few components that I want to focus on, which are the client components. We had a number of sensors, such as pressure and temperature and humidity, CO2, particulate sensor, and so on, that needed to send data to the cloud. And then we also had our local cameras that grab pictures of the duct status and send them to the cloud to a machine learning model. So we had to build a board able to collect this data and then send data through AWS IoT, and then be able to manage this data and make that available for standard REST endpoints. Today, we're gonna focus on the local and edge part of the story, and we are gonna see how CDK can help even in provisioning edge devices, because every time that we provision an edge device, and every time that we build and create an iOS IoT thing, we need to deploy even something in the cloud. And this is the part in which CDK can play a huge huge advantage. Just let's have a look at the kind of board that I'm referring to. What we mean with remote air board is a custom design board, but it is basically a Raspberry board. So it uses Raspberry Compute Module 3, which is the enterprise grade Raspberry version, and it can be mounted on a custom board. And we had to build a custom board because we needed a couple of devices to be directly wired connected to the board using E2C bus. Especially, we need to implement a multiplexer, an hardware multiplexer, to select the right channel before talking to the devices, because with I2C, all the devices share the same address space. And if you have two sensors of the same kind, they are pushing the data on the same address. So you need a multiplexer to communicate and to choose between them and to enable the channel before collecting the data. This means basically to our understanding that we needed to build a custom board, and this custom board needed to have a lot of logic on board on the device. But also we had over the air sensors, which means that we want to monitor the air quality for a wide area, especially inside a mall or inside a huge company plant, in which we need to put the sensor, which are pressure, humidity, particulate sensor, and so on, across all the surface, across all the establishment that we are monitoring. So we needed over-the-air communication because we needed to make that cost-effective. So we couldn't provision a board, a Raspberry board, for each one of these sensors because it would have been costed too much. But we planned to have this board acting as an edge gateway. And this is very important because my idea is that you cannot and you shouldn't send the data from the sensor directly to the cloud. This is great for your home or business purposes, or if you have a very reduced number of devices. But if you are covering a wide plant, if you are covering a wide area with a huge number of devices, and in IoT, more than 10, 15 could be considered huge, but you can scale up to hundreds of sensors in the same environment. Having each one of them connected directly to the cloud is not a good idea. It's not a good idea for security purposes because you have to enforce security on each one of them. And basically, since they are low-end and low-cost chipsets, you won't have the same security capability that you can have on more expensive devices such as Raspberry, or even dedicated board, or even industrial board or PLCs. And on the other side, managing the communication means also filtering the data, cleaning the data, which means that you have to duplicate a lot of code if you want to put the same logic on each one of the devices. And so we had this board to collect and forward data to the cloud after having cleaned the data and sent the data, after having been packed also to use the cloud communication efficiently. The board is able also to implement some kind of retry logic if something is not going well, because we cannot take for granted that the connection will be always on, always available. Even because you can have some kind of outages for, say, a few hours or even a few days. And what is relevant is that a single customer can have many plants, and each one of them can have many sensors and a couple of remote devices. And we needed also to deploy directly into their account the solution, because data related to air quality, especially these days, is really sensitive data. It's really sensitive because it is demonstrated that poor air quality can take to the spread of diseases. And so you have to be aware of not having a leakage of the data. And one of the main points that our customer asked was to having the complete stack deployed in their account. And we also needed to customize, to be able to customize the deployment and provisioning of a new device. We leveraged our architecture on AWS Greengrass. AWS Greengrass was presented a couple of years ago as a way to run Lambda function directly on edge devices. And recently, they have added also the capability to run containers. But Greengrass is much more than that, because Greengrass can provide a lot of connectors between different Lambdas and different containers in the same devices. So you can write and develop your Lambda in cloud and then shift that Lambda directly to on the device to be run on the edge device. And this lambda can also be marked as a long-running lambdas, which means that they won't be stopped after execution. And it is great for long-running tasks. It is also great for managing streams of data coming to the device. And the lambdas through Greengrass can also assess local resources available on the devices. So it's a great technology, and it supports a lot of connectors to AWS services. It also provides MQTT channels to handle communication. MQTT is a de facto standard protocol for IoT because it allows us to send small amounts of data in a tag frequency directly between different actors in our network and even to the cloud. But let's consider a simplified version of the previous architecture that we have seen for the scope of this talk. And we consider an architecture with a sensor device and with a remote air board and the local business logic that manages data collection. It manages cleaning the data and packaging the data and sending the data to the cloud. An IoT topic which receives data from a thing, but consider that the data coming to that thing should be differentiated depending on the type of the data and on the type of the sensor. And then an AWS Greengrass Core, which monitors and manages Lambda deployment and even Lambda updates over the air. This is very important because we want to be able to update our code as much as possible, because the device is not something that we control, is not something that we have in our AWS account, and is not something that we can have our CI/CD stack to roll out a new update. Is something that can be sent to a customer. It can be in any kind of venting or air conditioning system, even in a house or in a mall. And we would like to be able to directly access the board with not having to be there in place, to be able to update the code on that board. And for today's talk, we don't consider a connector and managing complex connectors except for IoT topic. Even this simple architecture require a lot of resources to be created in the cloud when we deploy a new board. And this is quite strange because we are deploying a new physical board, a new edge devices, but Greengrass requires us to create a huge number of resources in the cloud. That a deeper look, it is not so strange to understand, because since Greengrass has to manage a package of resources that belongs to that devices, which means certificates, it means IAM roles, it means policies to define what the device can or cannot do. And certificates are required to ensure authentication, because on the device, we don't have a user logging into. So unfortunately, we cannot use Cognito user pools or things like that on the device. We need a different way of authentication. And AWS provides us with certificate-based authentication, which is great because it's something that you provide to authenticate your login. But we need to define that in our thing configuration. And then we needed also to define a group and the device version, and a configuration of our device that we have to send back. And Lambda thinks about core versioning of all of these resources. So provisioning a new device means that we had to run through a couple of steps. Some of them happen on the device, and some others happen on the cloud. The first step is device setup, which is the initial step, because it is something that we have to do to configure the operating system and install IoT and Greengrass libraries. Then we need to create a corresponding thing in the cloud, because we need to create IoT certificates, policies, and so on to make that device being considered and being available as an IoT thing. Then we need to create all the stack belonging to Greengrass to provide the resources needed by the Greengrass group, which means that setting up a new device requires us to provide install the operating system, and we use Raspberry Pi OS or Raspbian. That's pretty easy. But after that, after the bare install, we needed to provide Wi-Fi connection, and a startup script could achieve that result. But we started having problems because we needed to configure all the device stack. So it means the libraries, it means all the specific device configuration, but also cloud connection. In this sample code, we can see what means configuring Greengrass using Ansible. Ansible is great because it's a standard, but configuring Greengrass using Ansible is not something which can be leveraged. And it's an option that to be considered, but it's not the best option that you have. Moreover, you have to provide IoT Things certificates. So you can install the bare system, you can use a bunch of Ansible scripts to provision the common libraries, and then you need to install to have a certificate. And how creating a certificate is a classical chicken and egg problem, because devices need credentials to access AWS resources and obtain a certificate, which in turn enables them to access AWS resources. And so you have to find the best approach available to you. You can install certificate on AWS beforehand delivering the devices, which is great, but is quite naive. Then you can provision by trusted user or provision by claim. And then we are going to discuss all of these three options. And just-in-time provisioning means that you are not embedding the device into the certificate into the device, which is great, but you are embedding something else. You are embedding a small bunch of language which resembles CloudFormation, which is provided as a string in this JSON, which support the JITP signature syntax. And once the device connects to AWS and connects to the endpoints, the profile, the provisioning profile, is sent to AWS. And if a role is attached to IoT thing, and the policy is embedded in the certificate, the thing is created. It is great, but because it allows us to perform unattended setup, so no one needs to be there. You have just to provide a Wi-Fi connection to the internet. There is no need for any kind of external app, so no app companion. But the device is in full control of the credentials, so it's not as bad as having the certificate. The final certificate embedded on the device, but you are embedding something that has the power to ask AWS to deliver, to send back a certificate, is not the best option in my understanding. And even on the security point of view, and configuring JITP is quite difficult because it's not so easy. You have to version to serialize as a string a lot of configuring. On the other side, you can build a companion app, such as the same that happens with Alexa and Echo. You have a companion app, you log into the companion app, you start building, calling a temp provisioning claim, and then on the app side, you log it with your user credential, and then you can authorize this request and make that available directly, firing from the app the request for the certificates, or downloading the certificates and sending them over Bluetooth to the device. This is great if you have a one-to-one matching between user and the device that are configuring, but it's quite unfeasible if you are working in an environment with many devices, because you have to configure each one of them one by one, and is not the best way to achieve that. Then we can see that security is enforced, because you cannot have unattended or unprevented access to the certificate, since the app companion is requiring the user to log into the system using Cognito and having an IAM role associated to that request. So when someone is asking for a certificate, it is an authorized actor in our system. Configuration is pretty easy, but it requires an external app and even user explicit approval. Then you have what is the so-called certificate-only claim, in which the device performs a claim and you have a restricted set of credentials attached to the device, and then it claims for a certificate. The policy asks for AWS IoT, which in turn has its own policy to ask for a certificate, and then the certificate is sent back. It is great because it also is supported through MQTT, so you can push on a MQTT topic, and you just only have to need the permission to push on that specific topic and have back a certificate, but you cannot perform unattended provisioning, and even different multi workflow and step and approval steps. The idea that you can build, and that we built using CDK, is building an AWS IoT vending machine in which the client has a public token which is sent to a backend, and the backend stores that token in an availability in an enabling table, which can be authorized before or after the provisioning of the resource. And then only once that token becomes authorized, and it can also be authorized automatically through API, the Lambda invokes IoT to generate a certificate. When a match is found, Lambda invokes AWS IoT, the certificate is built and sent back to the device. It's a better solution because solves a lot more problems and gives you the flexibility to have a registry of your devices waiting for approval and or being authorized. And this is for the first two points, because the other points of our list needs to be set up to be able to use Greengrass. And here is where CDK came into the play, because we were able to build a CDK construct that can be run locally from an host machine in the local network, or an host server in the local network, or from directly from the device that can execute code in the cloud. Remember that at this point, the device has an IoT certificate which is valid and allows them to run code in the cloud. So we can build the Greengrass group and Greengrass resources that we need. If we want enhanced security, we can have an external Docker container or server in our local network acting as a running point, an entry point for our CDK, and in which we can use CloudFormation instead of IoT APIs in order to provide a rollback and resources the deletion capability. And so we can write our stack to build core groups, Greengrass core groups, core logger, resources, and connector directly with CDK, which means that we can create the roles that we need, create instantiating a new Greengrass role, then we can create the core version, which is the basic entity within Greengrass, each Greengrass group needs to have at least one core, one Greengrass core, and we can also define loggers, resources, and connectors, and then attach them to the Greengrass group. And once we run this CloudFormation stack, and we can also run this directly from the device, we can provision all the cloud resources that we need for our new device, our new thing being installed. This means that we can complete the first part of the architecture, and then we can have the other standard services such as machine learning and REST services benefit from the data coming from edge devices. Let me wrap up about the what we have discussed so far. Then we have no currently best one-size-fits-all solution for device provisioning. We have different approaches, and each one of them needs to be considered in the light of your context, of the number of devices that you are supporting. Ansible could be an enabling technology because you can put all the device provisioning, then IoT provisioning, invoking the IoT vending machine, and then the Greengrass run part within an Ansible call. So you can have your provisioning container in your local network, or even directly, some part of the container, even directly on the device. We have been able to manage just one thing set up and then make that core able to provision the other things as soon as they are switched on into the customer's network. And getting a certificate could be achieved using certificate vending machine architecture, which is so far, in my opinion, one of the best architectures that you can implement to have full control of certificate delivering. And we have been able to script that with CDK with a very few line of codes. Then Greengrass provisioning can be done through CDK, even from a controller or the device itself. And Greengrass is really a game changer because you can deploy the code directly to the device. Then I suggest you to start with a bare OS and configure other containers into your devices to be deployed by Greengrass. Here I can leave you a few resources, especially two projects which are really great. The first one is from Nathan Glover, it is AWS Greengrass, and the second one is directly from AWS Labs, and it is a reference implementation of IoT certificate vending machine. It is not CDK. We managed to use that as a reference architecture, and then we re-implemented that with CDK, and I plan to release the component in the near future to be able to allow that to be used by the community, and then the Greengrass missing manual. And so you can find and download the slides. And I want to thank you for your time. I think I've been just right with times.
Yeah, absolutely. Down to the minute almost. So thank you so much, Luca. That was a great great talk, great timing. I think also a lot of great knowledge about IoT, right? So yeah. I liked especially that part. That's always good for to learn about. So thanks a lot for the talk. It was great.
And Merrick. Hey, Merrick. Yeah. Did you see the serverless in there?
Did you see the serverless?
Yes, okay. I'm just calling it out, Luca. I really, really was excited to see that. That made me very excited. I did a little happy dance. Nobody wants to see that, though. So great presentation. So I appreciate it.